Don't we rumble? Float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. Ah, rumble, young man, rumble.
Down goes Frazier!
It's time to get in the ring with the Corner Men, preparing dentists for the next round. We give you business insights, trends, and timely information. And we'll interview experts to help you make smart financial decisions. Now, here are your Corner Men, Rob Joyce and Mike Bark.
Welcome back to the Bull Moose Cornerman podcast. Today, I am happy to be joined by Brian Meehan of Celtic Incorporated. They're a marketing firm and PR firm located in Milwaukee's Third Ward. They're the firm that designed our website that we get quite a few compliments about and have helped us get through our branding. And we think it's probably going to be something useful for you guys as you go through, you know, not only this pandemic, but kind of maybe repositioning yourself as you come out of this pandemic. Brian, welcome.
Hey, Mike, thanks for having me. It's great to connect and I appreciate being invited on the show.
Can you tell us just a little bit about your guys' history, a little bit about your business? You know, kind of your brand, you know, is kind of heavily, let's say, Irish beer.
Yeah. We are, thank you for the intro. We are a full service marketing communication agency down in the Third Ward, just up the street from you. And a marketing communications agency, what do? Well, we have a variety of services. We do branding, advertising, public relations, social media, digital, and some other things. So we're an integrated firm. And what we do is some clients utilize all those services. Other clients may just come to us and say, we need a website or we need you to support our social media. So we do everything from full campaigns to project work. And our name is always is brought up. People say, is it Celtic or Celtic? We go by the Americanized version of Celtic. And why we're called that is because Celtic is a language. It's an ancient language, and it's a language that brought tribes throughout Europe together. And we just thought that was kind of a cool story for an ad agency, bringing all these stakeholders together to create customers and to create a brand. So that's kind of how we came up with our name, so to say. We do work in a variety of categories. One thing I'll say is we don't just work in the medical industry. You know, we work in travel tourism, food and beverage, financial services, active lifestyle, and healthcare is one of the arenas that we work in. And we've been fortunate to work with a lot of great brands that people probably are familiar with, but like Edvest, which is the state of Wisconsin's 529 college savings plan. That's one of our longstanding customers. We work with Summerfest. We work with Educators Credit Union. We work with George Webb Restaurants. People always love that one. That's my kid's favorite restaurant. So we work in a lot of different areas. And one of those also is in healthcare products and healthcare services. So we do work with some dental firms and some other healthcare services.
Excellent. So we have one of our clients who might either be starting out or looking to create a brand. At least we see a lot of focus based on their professional skill. And I've always thought to some extent, well, it's a given that you have some type of professional skill. What do you see them as doing right and doing wrong when it comes to their branding?
Yeah, it's a great question. And, you know, one thing I should probably mention, I'm a son of a dentist. My dad went to Northwestern University and then he had a dental practice in Morton Grove. And that was the era where you were a dentist, you didn't market at all. I think maybe he belonged to the Lions Club. And I think he had the oversized toothbrush and the oversized teeth that he took to school and showed the kids how to brush. That was the extent of it, right? We're now in such a different world with professional services where you do need to be out there. And when I talk to people, a lot of times what they'll say is, well, we need to do social media. We need to do some advertising. We need to do email. I always say, pump the brakes for a minute and really step back and figure out who you are. You know, a lot of times people say, well, my brand is my logo. It's not. You know, your brand is the soul of your organization. It's what makes you special. It's what makes you unique. It's what makes you different from your competitors. So a lot of times I like to sit back and say, well, what do you want to focus on? You know, is it, and you had a great point, a given is that you're a professional. It's a given. I assume that you can do your job. So from there, is it family dentistry? Is it I'm the, you know, gentle and caring, you know, dentist that wants to really be there for your family? Is it pain-free? Is it cosmetic? You know, what are those things that truly make you unique. And once you've kind of established that, is how do we now package that as a brand in everything that we do? So it's not just the logo, but it's the people that you hire. You know, it's the way you answer the phone. It's the way that you communicate with people, the tone and the voice that you have. And gone are the days where you can just hang a shingle and people will walk in the door. You know, in my city of Wauwatosa, you know, you have three or four family dentists that practice there. And they all say the same thing, last name, family dentist or family dentistry. Beyond that, I don't know anything about them. And that's not being critical. I don't mean to be that way, but I think it's really kind of defining who you are and then differentiating yourself from the competition in the market in everything that you do and really just hammering that through over and over and over, so that you can get some repetition and some brain share.
How much of their own, you know, do you think their own personality they should inject in something? Because again, you read a lot of their bios and it's going to focus on some of the professional credentials they have and those things. And those are important things. And then it kind of gets to the, well, I enjoy spending time outdoors and I sort of like my family and go Badgers or go Pack, something like that.
Yeah, great question. And it's hard because, you know, a lot of dentists were trained in that professional arena, right? Where it's like, we're professionals, we're doctors. This is serious. So what I always recommend is we're not going to go crazy and be goofy kooky for no reason. If your brand is about family dentistry, then position yourself that way in the way that you communicate with people. If it's pain-free, again, communicate that. And I think it's okay to start bringing out your personality and having a little fun. But there's a big difference between letting your personality come out a little bit and being goofy, crazy, which it just doesn't work in this industry. You know, you don't need to be a carnival barker. You don't need to be, you know, out there crazy, but I do think you got to have a little fun. You got to position yourself as more than just, you know, the credentials, I guess to say. So have a little fun and a little freedom with your marketing. That's a great way to break through, because right now a lot of dental practices are the same, you know, there's very little differentiation.
But even, you know, if I go to your guys' website right away, you know, it does give me a sense of who you guys are as a firm. You know, not that it's unprofessional in any way, but it comes across as relaxed. It comes across as conversational. It comes across as these are guys I could share a Guinness with and we could talk through business problems versus here is every single project that Brian Meehan has ever done and kind of look how cool this logo is that I did.
You know, that's another really good point is when we, you know, I'll speak about Celtic for a minute. It'd be real easy to be like, well, we do PR, we do marketing, we do advertising, and we look at it and go, so do 20 other agencies within three blocks of our office. So how are we going to differentiate ourselves? Well, some agencies go very down the technical road, you know, technically superior, Google Analytics, you know, data-driven decision-making. You know, we tried to take the approach of we're kind of like a Sherpa. You know, you're trying to scale this mountain with your business, and we're here to help you along the way. We're not going to be dictators. You know, we're not going to intimidate you at all. We're going to be approachable, likable. And like you said, guys and gals that you want to sit down and have a casual conversation. So translate to that to the dental industry. We know you do crowns and fillings and cleanings. That's the baseline. Now what makes you special? You know, what makes you special? Am I going to come into your environment and feel warm and welcomed? Am I going to feel appreciated? You know, am I going to walk into the environment and go, wow, this is impressive. Look at all of the new equipment that they have and all the advanced techniques that they're doing. Is it going to be, you know what, I'm going to come in and whether it's my kids or myself or my mom or dad, they can take care of it all and be welcoming to our family. So get beyond the services and get beyond the degree, because I think it's a baseline to be in the industry and really focus on what makes you unique. But stay true to your brand. You know, what I don't like to see is brands that just try to be crazy to be crazy or try to just be out there to be out there. If it doesn't match with who you truly are, the soul of your organization, then you shouldn't be doing it. But have a little fun, a little freedom to stand out.
How important is, you know, a lot of our clients right now are really obsessive with Google AdWords, Google reviews, things like that. In the research that you guys do, are you seeing that as being a big driver toward somebody coming into a business if somebody would have a negative review or something, or does the regular consumer kind of see that as there's a lot of people who like to complain that if somebody has a negative review, it's not the end of the world?
Well, I think that if you're into Google and AdWords and PPC, that is the place to be just tactically. I mean, you want to be seen when someone's searching dentist in Brookfield. You know, you want to be out there. But whenever it comes to anyone getting a negative review, you know, sometimes it's frustrating. I know that it's maybe not fair. But what we always encourage people to do is be proactive. So if there's a negative review, it'd simply be, hey, Mr. Bark, you know, I saw that you gave us a, you know, a less than perfect grade. We hate to see that. We'd love to learn more about how we can do better. Here's my phone number. Here's my email. Proactively address those things. The worst thing that you can do is try to hide things or ignore it. Obviously, if that standard of complaint goes into being belligerent or into a space where it's just really inappropriate, you have to try and get rid of that, especially on social media. You know, have a standard. It's like we're open to dialogue and discussion, but it has to be done respectfully, right? But sure. If it is a legitimate concern that someone has, address it. And as a consumer, what I like is I go in and go, look at this. You know, even if there is a negative comment, that they're concerned about it and they want to address it and they want to make it right. So don't ever be afraid to do that. But back to your point, I think that digital is the place to be. It's just the format that people are using. You know, they're using social media, they're utilizing Google, you know, they're utilizing pay-per-click. Those are places you need to be. And I really think where I see great opportunity is in social media. And the thing I wanted to kind of bring up, because a lot of times people ask us, you know, what's going on with my social media? You know, I'm not getting a ton of interaction. I'm not getting followers. What's happening? Well, I think what's important to understand is, let's look at Facebook. They have algorithms that determine what you're going to see in your stream, and more importantly, what you're not going to see in your stream. So if I'm a dentist and I post something organically, so it's just I put a picture up with a little bit of copy, probably about 5% of your target audience is actually going to see it, which is mind-boggling, because most people think, well, these are people that follow me. Mm-hmm. They want to be engaged with my brand. If you do it organically, 5% or less are seeing it. So what we're really encouraging is you've got to put some dollars behind your social media posts. So what we'd recommend is, you know what, maybe once or twice a month, you know, budget $25, $50, $100, and put that behind one of your posts. And what that's going to do is it's going to guarantee delivery to all your followers and can even extend beyond those followers. It can be friends of those followers. So if you put a little bit of money behind your posts, you're going to see a lot more reach and you're going to see a lot more engagement. It's a pay-to-play model nowadays. You know, people used to think, well, social media is sharing and everybody sees it. It's not the way it works. If you want to be seen, you have to put some dollars behind it.
When you're putting together a social media post or something like that, it seems like one of the missed opportunities by a lot of businesses is just simply not taking the opportunity to educate on some of the services that they can provide. So for example, you know, you think of a dentist or something like that, you kind of have a baseline understanding of, well, they fill cavities and do hygiene checks and whatever. When they're putting social media content out there, should it be targeted toward, here's some of the services I want to educate people about or I want to be able to sell? Or should it be more generic and more, you know, kind of branding type stuff? I mean,
yeah. Your position. Like it's a little bit of both. It's a little bit of both. The general rule of thumb with social media is you don't want it to be a spam machine where all you're doing is talking about yourself and how great you are and the services that you offer. You know, people engage in social media because there's something of interest to them. So they want something from that relationship. So it's like, you know, can you give me some brushing techniques? Can you share some interesting things that I can be doing to have better oral health? You know, share your expertise, share third-party resources. Have some fun, do some entertaining things that bring out the personality of your practice by maybe showcasing your people, put a face to the name, so to say. But you can certainly talk about your services. There's opportunity in social media to just be like, hey, wanted to remind you about some of the things that we do in our practice. But it can't be everything that you do because people will stop following. I mean, think about it. Like if you're interested in, you know, a certain product and every post is, let me tell you about the product and let me tell you about the product and let me tell you about the product. It's like, okay, time out. Tell me more about the category you're in. You know, if you're a dentist, share interesting things that I can take away and implement into my life because it's going to make you look like, you know, an expert and somebody that I would want to follow. If you just start spamming people left and right, you're never going to get the followers and engagement that you're looking for. So ask questions, do polls, post things about your practice and your people. I really like to see the people. I think that's huge, is who are the people in the operation, and have some fun. You know what I mean? We've been getting a ton of snow lately. Is there a way that you can play into that somehow? Play into trends, you know, that are happening out there. So yeah, you can talk about your services for sure, but really you need to be a third party resource that educates people and entertains people.
How important is it for somebody to be across, is it better to be across all the social media platforms, Google, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, or is it best to maybe focus on one and do it well?
Well, I think all dentists should be on TikTok. Let's just go there.
There we go.
maybe not. Maybe a little bit down the road on TikTok, but you have to look at the time and resources that you have. You know, if you're a international global consumer products brand, you can probably be on all those platforms and do a really good job. Knowing dentists and dental practice, they're busy. They've got a lot going on. What I always recommend is start with Facebook and Instagram. Start with those two. Set those pages up with graphics and descriptions and making sure that you have all the things that they ask for. Make sure that that's populated. And then put together what we call editorial calendars or calendars every month where it's like, okay, in the month of, you know, May, I am going to on these days post content about these types of topics and do a calendar and stick to it and share that with some of your, some of the people that work for you. Do a really good job growing. We're getting engagement. We're getting people to comment and like things. Then start to move into, all right, maybe we can do some YouTube videos. Maybe they can be demonstration types of videos or employee profile type of videos. But I would rather start small and do a good job than do the shotgun approach where you do nothing well.
I think most of our clients have some type of marketing budget and things like that. And we're guilty of it as a firm too, of not being able to, you get busy doing your own business and you kind of forget the marketing aspect.
Yep.
More so kind of engaging somebody and saying, we'd like you to sort of be responsible for this to make sure that it is getting done. And maybe we're getting 2 to 3 posts a month.
Absolutely. No, it's a great question. And what's interesting about social media is, again, when it first came out, many, many years ago, people did it on their own. It was free. I'll devote some time to it. And then they realized very quickly, I don't have the time or the patience to devote to this, nor should you. I mean, if you're a dentist, you should be focusing on your patients, right? So then they started assigning it to interns, you know, and they would come and go, and there were, you'd look at their Facebook pages, they weren't posting, the posts were not good, there was no engagement. So there was a real trend that I started to see about 2 years ago where they were looking for agency partners like us to say, listen, I want to turn the keys over. You have people that can monitor my page 24/7. You can develop the calendars. You can develop the posts. We write a lot of the content, or we'll work with our creative team to develop graphics and short little videos. And what we saw is fluency and professionalism, it just allowed dentists to just jet ahead of the competition because they were actually out there really focusing on the medium. So that's where outsourcing comes in handy. If you can't afford to outsource, maybe budgets are a little bit tighter, then I would look at, all right, well, get a college student, get an intern, and have them be responsible for it 24/7. Put the responsibility on them. Obviously, dentists can approve the content before it gets posted, but devote somebody to it versus, well, we've got 3 or 4 people in the practice that kind of do it. It's not going to work. You're wasting your time. I would rather have you contact someone like us where we can put a budget together to manage that monthly, or like I said, go to a university and get a social media intern.
Excellent. With the pandemic going on, I think a lot of people have had a chance, both good and bad, to kind of think about their business and maybe what their business should be going forward. Do you think there's certain branding or certain things people should be doing now within the pandemic, or shifting kind of what their marketing message is?
You know, it's a great point. When the pandemic hit back in March, a lot of practices shut down. They were forced to shut down. And the thing that we were encouraging at that point was, you know what, we know you may not be open for business, but there's still a value in being out there, not going dark. You need to stay of your patients to let them know about all of the safety protocols that you're putting in place, all the efforts that you're putting forth to get the business reopened. So I did see some practices that, you know, there was no statements on their website. They really weren't engaged in social media. And I thought that was a missed opportunity, because you don't want to go dark in a pandemic. You don't want to think, well, they must not be in business anymore. What I thought some dentists did that were great were, they shared stories. There was a lot of humanity to it, where they're like, you know what, this is a scary time. We don't know how this is going to impact the world. We don't know how it's going to impact our practice, but we want to let you know that we are going to be here. We're going to follow CDC guidelines. We're going to do whatever it takes to put your safety first. So I think the ones that got out there quick, you know, and really were proactive in their communication, really won at the end of the day. So now we get through, it's almost been a year, which is crazy to think about. Most are back open. What I really see is there's a great opportunity, and there's backfill with existing patients. A lot of patients that were on that 6-month rotation coming in, you know, maybe extended it to a year. You know, maybe they haven't scheduled that appointment. So what I'm really encouraging dentists to do is to be proactive in your outreach to existing customers or patients. Really let them know that we're open. Here's all the safety precautions and health and safety precautions we put in place. We want to welcome you back. Let's get an appointment scheduled. So how you do that? Do that through social media, you know, do that through email, do that through your website and your blog. Those are just real simple ways, low cost ways, quite frankly, to stay in touch with existing customers. But I also think this is the time for new patient acquisition. What I've seen across a lot of industries is when you have a major global event like we just had, people rethink things. You know, you're on autopilot through most of life, right? You know, every day it's kind of the same old, and we go through our day to day. But then you hit a pandemic, and I think people start to think differently about things. They may start to think about their relationships and who they do business with, and where they go to get their services and products. So I think this is a time now to say, hey, you know, get out there with a proactive marketing campaign where you welcome new patients. You know, maybe you have a special offer where it's free electric toothbrush, or, you know, free screening, or free, you know, x-rays, whatever that may be. But get out there on social media, paid social media, not just organic, but paid as well. Get out there via email. And one thing I think I want to talk about is, and maybe you've heard about it or not, but programmatic advertising. It's something that we've really been pushing. And what programmatic is in the old days, create a digital banner ad. And then you would go find a website to put it on. Right? You know, you pay for that space. And then you would hope that the people that you're targeting would come to that specific website on the day that your banner was there to deliver your message. It's kind of the old model. The new model with digital, and I think could work, and what we do is we're not targeting websites, we're targeting people. So what we do is we look at geography, you know, where do you live? What's your age and income? What are your search behaviors? So when you're online, what type of keywords are you putting in and searching for? Mm-hmm. And then we can deliver a targeted ad specifically to that person, whether they're on their smartphone, whether they're on their desktop, and no matter what they're on. So you could be on ESPN.com, you know, looking up stuff about the Packers, and all of a sudden I get served an ad because of, you know, the search criteria, and you know that I've looked for a dentist in the past and I fall within the age qualification at home, whatever that may be. But it's super, super targeted, and that's why we like it. And what we'd be recommending is, as people are coming out of this pandemic and they're busier than ever, I know they are, dentists, don't forget about looking for new patients. It's easy to kind of put them on the back burner, but maybe you look at it and say, well, I'm in the town or city of Brookfield. I want to do a targeted programmatic campaign in the city of Brookfield. And I want to target these types of people with these types of needs with an ad about my practice. And it could be schedule now, book now, new patient promotion, that type of thing. Don't forget about the new patient acquisition piece of this recovery.
Well, I think, I mean, one of the big missed opportunities is most of our clients are investing in things like air filters and things like that, but not necessarily telling their patients, hey, look, we put $20,000 out to completely upgrade our filtration. We've always kind of been at the forefront of being a, you know, sanitary environment per se with a lot of the protocols that we already had in place. And I think just highlighting that would help people understand it's okay to come back.
I mean, that recovery and that mindset of being safe and worrying about being around people, it's going to take some time. I mean, it's going to take some time to get people back. So let's use the hotel industry as a great example. I had to travel not too long ago. I get to the door of my hotel and they have a safety and sanitary sticker that you had to break the seal to get into the room. When you get into the room, the remote about how they use UVC light to disinfect the remote control. You go into the bathroom and they talk about all the cleaning procedures that went into my stay. And I look at that and go, they get it. They understand that to get people back into those hotel rooms, you really need to be marketing what you're doing to keep people. You're absolutely right. You know, as I go out and do my research, you see some firms that it's like the pandemic never happened. They haven't changed their website. They haven't changed anything on social media. It's just business as usual. The ones that I think are winning are the ones that realize that the number one thing I got to let people know is the investment that I've put in to keeping you healthy.
Yeah, that was a really good point though with the hotels of being able to say, you may have been apprehensive the first time going into a hotel, but now, you know, the hotel's business is hopefully you want to stay in the hotel more often. It's going to be easier to get you to go the next time because of the precautions.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I recently switched dentists and one of the things that I looked at was their website and they talked a lot about, even had a blog post about all the things that they had done and the investments that were made. And, you know, it was park out and meet you and we'll escort you in. And I just felt very comfortable. And I told them that I'm like, you know what, I have worries walking in here. So you look at that and go, it wasn't necessarily the service that was offered or the credentials of the dentist. It was the safety protocols. Health and safety protocols that get seriously take a look at this firm. So again, if you think that it's just going to be one day, masks are off and we're back to pre-COVID, it's not the reality. Feel safe going out, but there's a lot of people and they're going to take a lot of encouragement to say, come on back. And that's why I think there's so much opportunity with existing patients to say, hey, it's been a year, we miss you. Mm-hmm. You know, and we want to welcome you back and take care of you, but there's also need to go after new patients and talk about all the great things that you're doing to keep them healthy and safe.
Excellent. So in terms of putting together a marketing budget or something like that, is there a right or wrong answer between, you know, how much should be website, how much should be social media? Is there a better place to spend money right now? You know, we've had clients ask us, should I do radio ads? Should I do television ads? Is there any really right answer? It just kind of depends on, you know, maybe the client and what they're looking to obtain through the advertising.
Yeah, you know, I don't believe in a cookie cutter approach where it's pick package A and that's what you go with. I think what you need to do is sit down first and just have an honest discussion about, you know, who are you targeting? Who's your ideal customer? What's your geography? You know, what's the competition look like in the marketplace currently doing from a marketing perspective? Can you measure it? You know, have you had success? What's working? What's not working? So you really got to get under the hood to start with and figure out, you know, what are you trying to accomplish and what kind of dollars do you have? And then what we do is we come back as a sit down collectively, all the different, what's the best way to reach these people? What's the most cost-effective way to reach these people? What should the messaging be? You know, so it's not just we need to be on radio, but all right, if you're on radio, how are you going to talk to people? You know, how are you going to position your practice? So I like looking at a customized approach. But with that said, one thing that I always recommend is don't stick with just one thing. You know, people would just be like, we're going 100% digital. And it's like, that's great. Digital is certainly where you need to live. But realize that your target audience, if you're in family dentistry and it's 35 plus, kids in the home, looking for family dentistry, people through traditional mediums as well. I mean, radio is effective. But what I found is with limited budgets, we have to be as targeted as possible. So a lot of times radio is a big shotgun blast. You're reaching big numbers, but are those prospective customers, right? Where through Facebook advertising, we can be very, I mean, like you can really drill down to that customer and find out exactly where they are. So it's a very efficient way to market. So to answer your question, long story short, is it depends. It depends, but don't be single channeled, be multiple channeled. I like where it's like, hey, I saw something on my computer while I was at work, and then I heard them on the radio, or I got an email from them. So try to use multiple channels to reach people. It's the most effective way to do marketing and advertising.
How important is it for, if you're doing an advertising campaign, to kind of to build in some accountability for it and looking at, if I spend X amount of dollars, be it Facebook or Google, should you have some type of expectation of what you're getting back on it, on that, and try to assess, you know, what advertising might work better for what you're looking to do?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, in the olden days when I got into the business, you know, you'd run a print ad and you'd say, hey, we reached 5,000 people. That was the report. You know, did they do anything? Did they see the ad? Who knows? But, you know, they say their circulation is 5,000, so we must have reached those people. Now, enter the digital revolution and digital world. Everybody wants measurability. They want dollar for dollar. They're like, if I'm going to spend X amount of dollars, how many hits am I going to get to the website? How many clicks am I going to appointment now? How many phone calls am I going to get? Sometimes it's tough to measure, but you should absolutely, if you're doing this alone or you're working with an agency, be going to your vendor partners and saying, all right, you know, I invested $10,000 in a programmatic digital campaign. What were the results? Mm-hmm. How many hits to the website did I get? Where did they go on the website? What pages did they go to? How much time did they spend on the site? Did they book? And then more importantly, a retargeting campaign. A retargeting campaign is what that means is when someone comes to your website and leaves, we can serve them ads because there's a pixel that gets placed on them. So if Mike comes in, checks out my website, leaves, chances are you're going to get served one of my digital ads down the road and go, oh, there's Smith Dentistry again. Right. In this world, the answer is yes, 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 yes on analytics. And any client that we work with, they demand it. And they look at it on a monthly basis of let's pull the numbers. Well, let's tweak our campaign if we have to tweak it. Maybe less types of ads with different messages and different looks to see which one is performing better than the other. So the set it and forget it isn't happening. The one thing I do want to mention, though, is I've talked a ton about digital. There's still room for radio and print and outdoor and more traditional mediums. There certainly is. I think it's a combination of both. You know, maybe you do some radio advertising to get that big blast out there, but then you do a Facebook campaign or a program campaign. It's hyper.
Well, and I think that's a great point, because if let's say you're focusing on implant dentistry or something like that, your target audience tends to be older, and your target audience probably isn't on Facebook as much. They are actually buying a newspaper or doing it that way, or listening to the radio or whatnot, and that's where they hear about you. So it is important to probably figure out what your market is and, okay, what's the best way now to reach them at that point?
Yeah, you know, like our media director, who's responsible for purchasing media, you know, they have reps coming in all the time saying, you should advertise with us and we can reach that audience, you know, and really get an understanding of who's my customer, not just their demographics, but their psychographics. Like, what do they like to do in their hobby time? You know, what do they do in their free time? What sports teams do they like? Get a really deep understanding of that person and then select the mediums, because you're right. If I'm targeting a senior audience, print might still be a very smart way to go, a 50 plus magazine or something along those lines. Or if I'm targeting the young mom, probably not print, right? You know, right. You're probably on social media and you're probably, online.
Well, let's wrap it up with a really important question. Despite our mild-mannered looks and everything, and we kind of look like, you know, suburban dad thing, we're both big Metallica fans.
Absolutely.
What's their best album? It's the age-old debate.
Ooh, that's a tough one. You know, it's funny you bring up heavy metal, because when I do talk to people, especially students, what's something we don't know about you? I'm like, I'm actually a classic 80s metal fan. And they just kind of look, they're like, you look like some dad, which I am. But I love my metal. Metallica, I'm a big fan of their early stuff. So everything from Kill 'Em All the way through and Justice for All. I start to fade after that a little bit. I'm more of the old school. But best album has to be Master. The reason being is, they're both great albums. It's like picking which kid you love the most. But Masters was something that I just never heard of in my life. It literally, I put the vinyl down on it. I bought it at Record City in Northbrook, Illinois. I put the vinyl down and my jaw hit the ground. I've never heard anything like it before. So it was a very transformational album. I think I've said to you, it was like, you know, the Abbey Road of, you know, for the Beatles, where it's just something that I'd never heard before. And I remember when I went to go see him in concert on the Master Puppets tour for Warming Up for Ozzy, they finished their set and people were just like stunned. Because we had been used to this 80s pop metal type of thing that was going on. And out come these guys in t-shirts and bell bottoms. And it was just crazy. I'd never seen anything like it. So that was, I'd have to go Masters. What about you?
I would go in Justice for All. And I think for a lot of the same reasons, because my first exposure was really when they finally got on MTV with One. And, you know, I, like most people in the 80s, I liked all the hair metal stuff and everything. And then Guns N' Roses kind of came out and they seemed a little more serious. And then these guys come out and are like, well, it's completely different. Because up to that point, I was afraid of the kids you'd see with Metallica, jean jackets and back patches and whatnot. You know, so guys like you.
Different album, but same reason. Like you said, just transformational. Never heard anything like it. It was incredible.
But I think that also just ties into branding. It's right place, right time. You kind of develop a relationship with something and hopefully a loyalty to it. And that's where you go. We'd like to thank Ryan for joining us today on our podcast. You can reach him at Celtic, depending on which pronunciation you want to use. It's CelticInc.com. They're located here in the Third Ward. A great resource for all your branding needs. And if you have any questions, feel free to shoot them over. So hope you join us next time on our podcast. We'll see you next week.
Cheers.
Thank you for listening to The Corner Men. Be sure to leave us a review and subscribe to us wherever podcasts are found. For more insights and information, visit us at bullmoosefinancial.com.